أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله مالك الملك مجري الفلك مسخر الرياح فالق الإصباح ديان الدين رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الخلق وخاتم الأنبياء وسيد المرسلين نبينا وحبيب قلوبنا وشفيع ذنوبنا أبي القاسم محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المطهرين المكرمين سيما سيدنا ومولانا وصاحب أمرنا وولي زماننا الحجة بن الحسن المهدي روحي وأرواح العالمين له الفدا. قال الله العظيم في كتابه الكريم وهو أحسن القائلين وأصدق الصادقين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم حتى إذا جاء أحدهم الموت قال رب ارجعون لعلي أعمل صالحا فيما تركت كلا إنها كلمة هو قائلها ومن ورائهم برزخ إلى يوم يبعثون. آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم. For the purification of the souls and the enlightenment of the hearts and for the hastening of the reappearance of بقية الله الأعظم. روحي وأرواح العالمين له الفدا. Enlighten your souls and the atmosphere with the recitation of salawat upon Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. السلام عليك سيدي ومولاي يا أبا عبد الله وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك عليك مني سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار ولا جعله الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم. السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. Respected elders, brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Why is the sky blue? Does chewing gum remain in our intestines for years? Why is it that we can't tickle ourselves, whereas others do so? What does okay stand for? These questions, you may be wondering, are what? They are part of a list which was entitled as the 101 most commonly asked questions listed by the BBC in 2009. Some of these questions you and I may have had, or may indeed have asked, which highlights the inquisitive nature of human beings. You and I establish and utilize the tool of questioning in order to extract information, in order to communicate between ourselves, in order to indeed understand what is there to be understood. Sometimes questioning is of the utmost importance when it comes to certain tasks that you and I may be performing. We ask intuitively, subconsciously, throughout our daily lives, we ask a number of questions. Yet when we go to certain places, questions are an integral part of the process. Like what? Like interviews. If you go to an interview, they will ask you questions. Once somebody went to an interview, and the person interviewing that person said, I will give you a choice. I will either ask you one difficult question or 99 easy questions. Which one will you choose? The person responded back by saying, I will choose the difficult question. So the interviewee said, fine, tell me, which came first, the chicken or the egg? The respondent said, the egg. The person interviewing said, why? Can you explain why the egg came first? The person looked at him and said, you said one question, that's the end of it. You can't ask any more. In other words, sometimes questioning has an art, has a particular way. Certain disciplines in our lives out there in society charge you for questions. Like what? Like lawyers and solicitors. One person one day charged into an attorney's office and demanded to see the lawyer. He went to see the lawyer and said to him, how much do you charge when it comes to seeing people? The man responded and said, I charge $500 for three questions. This man said to him, isn't $500 quite a lot? He said, yes. Then the lawyer looked at him and said, sorry, what was your third question? In other words, that sometimes when it comes to questioning, you and I require it. It is a need in our lives. The religion of Islam states the importance of questioning cannot be undermined. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Utilize questions. We have narrations from the Ahlul Bayt alayhum as-salam that says, ask as many questions to the extent that people will call you insane. Ask as many questions to establish the truth so that you can get to where you wish to get. Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. He would say, al-ilmu makhazin, that ilm and knowledge is a treasure. Wa miftahuha as-su'al, that in order for you to get this treasure, in order for you to get this knowledge, you need to ask. Fas'alu yarhamkumullah, ask, may the mercy of Allah be upon you. فَإِنَّهُ يُرْحَمُ السَّائِلِ, because the mercy of Allah comes down upon four individuals, whom the Prophet of Islam says, the one who asks, وَالْمُجِيبِ, the one who answers, وَالْمُسْتَمِعِ إِلَيْهِمَا, and the one who's sitting there listening to this question and answer taking place. Who's the fourth person? Who would be the fourth person who would get reward? Yes, the one who asks gets reward according to the Prophet, the one who answers, and the one who's sitting in that majlis and gathering. Rasulullah says, وَالْمُحِبْ لَهُمَا, the one who loves to see this questioning and answer taking place will attain reward from the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala. This tool of questioning is of great importance. Hence, when it comes to seeking knowledge of religion, which is something that you and I are encouraged and greatly recommended to do, because the Prophet of Islam, peace and blessings be upon him and his holy progeny, says, تَفَقَّهُ فِي الدِّينِ فَإِنَّهُ مَنْ لَمْ يَتَفَقَّهُ فِي الدِّينِ لَمْ يَنْظُرِ اللَّهُ إِلَيْهِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ وَلَمْ يُزَكِّ لَهُ عَمَلًا. Rasulullah says, seek knowledge and improve your understanding of religion. Because if you do not do so, Allah would not even look at you on the day of judgment and would not verify your actions. Ask yourself this question. When was the last time that I picked up an Islamic book and I improved my understanding of faith? When was the last time that I sought a good article, a reputable article from an Islamic website in order to clarify a misconception? When was the last time that I had a question and I presented it to a scholar and I reflected and I contemplated and I thought over it? In other words, this seeking of the knowledge has to utilize what? Has to utilize questioning. Therefore, when it comes to questioning, it has adab. It has recommendations. What do we need to think or ponder upon when it comes to asking question? The first thing we have to do is, what is our intention when we ask a question? When I come to present a question to somebody, is my intention to somehow judge whether they know or not, or is it to seek knowledge? Because sometimes what we do is, we like to test people. We like to see whether they're knowledgeable or not. So we see a scholar, we see someone with knowledge, we come to them and say, you know what, I have the answer to this question, but let me see if he truly knows what he's talking about. That is considered something which the religion of Islam discourages you and I from doing. Number one, Number two, understand what questions to ask when. Think about the situation. Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, would say, Saluni qabla an tafqiduni. Ask me before you lose me. And one day when he was saying this, a person by the name of Sa'ad ibn Abi Waqqas, the father of Umar ibn Sa'ad, the commander of the army of Ubaidillah ibn Ziyad in Karbala on the 10th of Muharram, his father, Sa'ad ibn Abi Waqqas, says, yes, Ya Ali, I have a question for you. Imam said, what's your question? He says, how many pieces of hair do I have on my head? That was his question. Amir al-Mu'mineen looks at him and says, by God, I can tell you how many pieces of hair you have. But what I can tell you also is the fact that I can see on every piece of hair on your head a shaitan sitting. There's a shaitan sitting on every piece of hair on your head. However, what I will tell you is this, that your son will stand one day to kill my son, the grandson of the Holy Prophet. That's number two. In other words, understand what? Understand the importance of recognizing what to ask and when to ask. Number three of the etiquettes of questioning is what? Is when you don't know the answer, when you are asked, there is no problem in saying, I don't know. There is no problem in admitting one's shortcoming. Sometimes when we ask questions, and unfortunately today, with the expansion of social media, we have a number of prominent individuals who are called Ayatollahs. We have Ayatollah Google and Hujjatul Islam Facebook. Why? Because people post on Facebook, on Twitter, what is the ruling? For instance, if I do not have time to perform wudu and it's time for Salatul Fajr. You have a list of people pointing and presenting their opinions. And if somebody asks them a question, this is what they respond to. Don't worry, I'm in social media, I know. This is not what people have told me. I've seen this myself. When some people ask the question on social media, people respond like this. I'm not sure of the answer, but I think it's this. Why are you answering then? Why are you presenting your opinion when you say that I'm not sure of the answer? Or likewise, what people say is, I think the answer to this question is this, but I think if you want, ask someone more knowledgeable. In other words, we have a responsibility. If we speak about something that we do not know, if we give an opinion about something that we are unsure of, then we will be held accountable by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of judgment. Another important etiquette of asking is what? To recognize that sometimes there are questions that should not be asked. Please pay attention to this, my dear brothers and sisters. What do we mean? We mean that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran says what? Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, la tas'alu an ashya'a in tubda lakum tasu'kum. O you who believe, don't ask about things in which if the answer is given to you, what? It will make you in a worse state. It will make you in a worse position. Allah says, don't ask about certain questions which will impact negatively upon you. Like what? Like before creation, what happened? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was there alone. What was he doing? How long did it take? What was this process all about? Our mental capacity, our rational mind cannot comprehend this. Therefore, we should not ask. It is not for us to ask. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us an example in this. In the story of what? In the story of Musa and Khidr. When Khidr came to see Musa, when Musa thought that he had the knowledge, the story is found in chapter 18, Surah Al-Kahf. Most of you have come across it. Khidr comes to Musa and says to him, come with me on a journey. They go on a journey and Khidr performs a number of acts. He performs a number of actions and deeds. And Musa is astounded. He's astonished. Like what? Khidr comes, sees a young man, kills him. Just like that. Musa says, hold on a minute. You're killing an innocent soul? Why? Why are you doing this? You shouldn't do this. He knows that Khidr has been sent by Allah. He knows that Khidr has a specific mission. Khidr looks at him and says, did I not tell you that you are unable to remain patient with me? Musa says, I'm sorry, I forgot. Please, next time I ask you, you could leave me. They move on. They ride on a boat, on an actual ship. And Khidr sinks or has a hole, digs a hole in the ship. Water starts emerging inside. it will begin to what? Sink. Musa says, why are you doing this? Surely this is unjust. Once again, Khidr responds to the same thing. They go to a city whereby the wall is collapsing and the people of the city do not give them food, are not hospitable to them. Yet Khidr builds this wall. Musa says, these people don't deserve for the wall to be built. Khidr says, see, this is the point that we separate. That you are unable to withstand what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded me to do. In other words, sometimes we have to hold back from certain questions which become problematic. Here, we have to ask a question. A question that is pertinent and quite crucial in our lives. I ask you and I call my dear brothers and sisters, if you have not asked yourself this question, ask it very soon. What is that question? One day, all by yourself, with no one around you, no distractions, ask yourself this question. What happens if I die tomorrow? What will happen to me? Am I ready? Have I prepared for this journey? In which position would I meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? This is a question that indeed shakes the essence of the human being. Indeed, it wakes up many individuals who are absent-minded and are asleep. Ask yourself this question. If tomorrow is my last day on this earth, how will I face my Lord? In which position I would indeed present my actions and my deed? Because a frightening realization, my dear brothers and sisters, about death is that it is not reversible. It is indeed irreversible. You cannot go back. Once you pass this dimension and this existence, there is no going back. The fact is that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has established this in the Quran. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says that when death comes to them, they say, قَالَ رَبِّ ارْجِعُونَ. They beg, they plead, they beseech Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, people generally. Why? Because they see the truth. They see everything manifested before them. Therefore, they beg Allah. They say, oh Allah, take us back to dunya just for a short while. Please, I will be righteous. I will be good. You know what? I miscalculated. I did what I should not have done. I took the wrong choices. I associated myself with the wrong people. Oh Allah, give me one more chance. And Allah says, kalla. Never. Nay, innaha kalimatun huwa qailuha. This is something that you claim. وَمِنْ وَرَائِهِمْ بَرْزَخٌ إِلَىٰ يَوْمِ يُبْعَثُونَ. And after them, there is what? The intermediary world known as barzakh. You cannot go back. It is irreversible. This is, my dear brothers and sisters, a shocking realization. Something that would shake us to the core, that I am unable to repair whatever I have done. I may lose my business. God forbid, I may lose my car. God forbid, I may fail my exams in school and college. All these I can do something about. All these I can go and repair. But once I pass from this dunya, there is indeed no way of coming back. And sometimes we come across stories of people who witness this in themselves and live to tell people how. I've recalled this story in many occasions of the famous author of the tafsir of the Quran, Majma'ul Bayan, Allama Tabrisi, his name is. Others call him Tabarsi. What did he do? He passed away. He died. His family came. They did all the rituals. They prepared his body. And they placed his body inside the grave. Back in the time, they used to do this very quickly. And as we will speak in a few moments, this is the recommendation. That the body is buried very quickly. As soon as he was buried, and they placed the small bricks of concrete on top of him, and they sealed the grave, what happened? His heart started to pump again. Allah gave him life once more. This is a true story. This is not a Hollywood movie. His heart started to pump again. Now, can you imagine? You're 6 feet under and you wake up. And what do you see? You see that you are surrounded by clay and dust and soil, and you have only a few minutes to live because oxygen supply is limited. At that moment, put yourself in the position of this great scholar. What would you do? I'll tell you what some of us will do. Some of us will scream, help, but no one would hear us. 6 feet under. No one would hear us. Others would think, call 911. Right? There's no cell phone. Nothing to help us. Yet Shaykh al-Tabrasi had one communication, which is the only that would help if you're in a difficult position. And that is what? A direct route to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A number that he would dial, but not on a cell phone, but through dua and supplication. That when you have this close proximity and relationship with your Creator, the first thing you think about when you're in deep trouble is Him and Him alone. You don't think about anyone else. You think about Allah, your Creator, who's the only one who can get you out of this mess. So Shaykh al-Tabrasi speaks to his Lord. He says, oh Allah, if you get me out of this grave alive, I will write a tafsir of the Quran for your sake. I will write a commentary of the Quran. Now what happened was, there was a man who used to wait in the cemeteries when the bodies have been buried, and he would come open up the graves and steal the shroud, the kafan. He heard there is a scholar out there that's been buried. He thought with himself, ah, scholar, nice kafan, quite worthy. Let me wait. He waited when people dispersed. As soon as Allama Tabrasi indeed came back to life once more, he opened up the grave. Can you imagine what he saw? As soon as he opened up the grave, he could see movement. The guy was absolutely petrified. He started to come out of the grave in order to run away. Allama Tabrasi from inside the kafan would call him and say, hold on, wait. I know what you're here for. You're here to steal my kafan. Don't worry. If you help me come out, because I'm tired at the moment, if you help me come out, I'll give you my kafan later. So Allah guided this young man, this thief. He guided him. So he helped Allama Tabrasi come out of the grave and he took him home. Now can you imagine at home what was happening? They had a majlis aza and the door is knocked. They open the door and it's the Allama himself. He says to them, what? I'm back. Of course, he didn't say this. I made that up. However, the idea is what? He says to them that I'm here. Now, what happened is that when they saw this, they were amazed. Now, that young man who was a thief was guided by Allama Tabrasi. Later on, he became a knowledgeable individual and repented from the actions. Most of us do not get this opportunity to return. The vast majority are in this difficult position that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, think about it, reflect upon it, make it a point of instrumental change. So that what? So that when it comes to that state, you do not have the desire to return. You are in a position to say, oh Allah, I'm ready to face whatever is presented before me. Hence, there is a need for us to look at this journey, both physically and spiritually. There are a number of questions when it comes to the afterlife. The youth may have a number of ideas in their minds as to what happens. Why is it that we do what we do when somebody passes away? The purpose of these particular lectures is to answer these questions in a calm, academic, rational way using the Quran and the teachings of the Holy Prophet. One of the first questions that some people may have is the following. They say, why do some people die when they're young and others die when they're old and some die in their middle age? Why do people not all die at the same age? What is this concept of ajal? This is very important. I invite you to think about and to reflect about what I'm about to say, because it will help us. And one of the areas that I will focus upon, inshallah, and I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's assistance in this, is for this discussion to be practical. For this discussion to be something that we can take away and apply to our lives, not just to increase our knowledge, but to do what? For it to assist us in our lives. People ask, where is this ajal? Because the Quran says, فَإِذَا جَاءَ أَجَلُهُمْ لَا يَسْتَأْخِرُونَ سَاعَةً وَلَا يَسْتَقْدِمُونَ. That if the time for death would come to them, that's it. That's the time that they would pass away. No one can change this. It is indeed the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is this how we should understand ajal? Is this what ajal is all about? Think about it. Reflect about what I will going to say. Because what we are told is that there are two ajals. What do we mean, two ajals? There are two set times for us to die. What do we mean? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Holy Quran says, there is an ajal that is known as ajal mahtoom. And there is an ajal known as ajal mawquf. What does this mean? Ajal mahtoom means that the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala, for instance, has made my age, how long I will live, as say, for instance, 90 years. I cannot live more than 90 years. That's the maximum that I would live. Yet, he's also set a minimum age that I would live. He would say the minimum age would be 60. And between 60 and 90, I am the one who determines how long I live. What do we mean? There are certain actions, there are certain deeds, which determines how long I live in this world. So I could live to my maximum, which is 90, or I could die in my minimum, which is what? As an example, 60. That's why you have, when it comes to the differing times in which people pass away, this variation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of course, knows best. Yet think about it in this possible way, that the Quran states there are certain deeds that if you and I do, we can live longer. Like what? Like salatul rahim, enjoining blood relations. How many of us, God forbid, have severed relations with those whom we have a connection with, familial connection with, blood connection, blood relatives, over simple things? Oh, I don't want to speak to him because he did not come and congratulate me for my birthday. I don't want to have anything to do with him because he spread rumors about me. I have nothing to do with her because she never attended my wedding. How many of us have this particular type of thinking about our family members? We don't speak to our uncles. God forbid, sometimes we severed our relations with our parents. The Quran comes forward and states the following. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, be careful not to sever your relationship with your blood relatives. Why? Because the Almighty will send His curses upon you. In Surah Muhammad, in Ayah 22, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. فَهَلْ عَسَيْتُمْ أَن تَوَلَّيْتُمْ أَن تُفْسِدُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَتُقَطِّعُوا أَرْحَامَكُمْ. Allah says, do you think you can cause corruption on this earth and sever your blood relatives, the relationships with them? أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ what? لَعَنَهُمُ اللَّهِ. That's chilling. That's frightening. That today, if I'm sitting in the majlis of Aba Abdullah al-Hussein and I don't speak to my relatives, Allah is sending His la'an upon me. The Quran doesn't say, you know what? You may be right, but the other person's wrong. It doesn't matter. The idea is, irrespective of what you think, because most of the times both sides think that they're right. Both sides think that the other is wrong and they've been what? Dealt with unjustly. They've been oppressed. Therefore they say, if he doesn't come and say sorry to me, I'll never go and say sorry to him. And we stay there for years and years. I've met people that they haven't spoken to some of their relatives for 20, 30, 40 years. Allahu Akbar. The ayah of the Quran, brothers and sisters, is absolutely explicit. The Quran says that the curse of Allah will fall upon you. Our holy seventh Imam, Imam Musa ibn Ja'far al-Kadhim, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, one day saw a man by the name of Ali ibn Abi Hamza. He said to him, tomorrow somebody will come to you from Maghrib, from Morocco, and he will ask to see me. Bring him in the pilgrimage during the Hajj. Ali ibn Abi Hamza, standing next to the Kaaba, there's a man who is from Maghrib, comes and asks this particular individual, do you know Musa ibn Ja'far? The man says, yes, I know him and I can take you to him. So he takes him to the Imam. Imam looks at this Maghribi, this man from Maghrib, and says, woe be to you. This man says, before saying anything, he says, oh, the grandson of the Prophet, what's happened? Have I done anything wrong? He said, yes, you and your brother started labeling each other and sending shetim, words of abuse against each other. And you no longer speak with each other. Hada laysa dini wa dinu abai. This is not my religion and the religion of my forefathers. And because of this, God the Almighty has shortened the life of your brother. When you're going to go back to Morocco, you'll find that he's died. This Moroccan man said, are you serious? Does that mean I'm going to die as well? Imam says, no. You and your life has been extended 20 years. Why? Because you continuously visit your mother. You continuously have respect for your mother. And that's part of Salatul Rahim. And therefore Allah has extended your lifespan. This man says, when I returned to Morocco, I saw exactly what Imam Musa al-Kadhim had indeed predicted, that my brother had died due to an illness. And I became so remorseful that I engaged in this particular activity and I exchanged these words of abuse with him. This month of Muharram and the commemoration of the Shahada of Aba Abdullah al-Hussein, my dear brothers and sisters, is a station to look at our akhlaq. It's an opportunity to look at our manners, how we deal with others, how we deal with our family members. Let's re-examine that. Let's begin a new, fresh chapter so that we are blessed under the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Indeed, and the Ahlul Bayt alayhum as-salam would be pleased with us. Hence, what do we find? We find Salatul Rahim is of the utmost importance that the Ahlul Bayt alayhum as-salam have encouraged and emphasized. The question that we have to ask also and attempt to answer, when somebody dies, what happens to them and what are we supposed to do with them? In other words, most of us may have seen or heard or come across family members who have passed away. When we see these rituals, we need to understand the process. We need to be in the position to explain it to non-Muslims. We need to explain it to our own children, to our own family members. All the things that go on and happen before our own eyes, we need to be able to what? Understand. And sometimes there are philosophies for it. There are reasons for it. The religion of Islam is a beautiful religion that sometimes has placed rational considerations for certain actions that you and I are commanded to do. We have books such as the book Ilanu Shara'i' by Sheikh al-Saduq, Radwanullahi ta'ala alayh. Sheikh al-Saduq comes and looks at all the obligatory actions and attempts to give reasons why we do it. Why is it that we fast? Why is it that we pray? Why do we go to Hajj? Why do we commemorate the martyrdom of Imam al-Hussein? Why is it that we deal with dead bodies the way we do? Let's look at what is wajib and what is recommended so that our knowledge is increased and we are aware in this journey of death. And in the next few minutes, I want you to think about an individual, in other words, ideally yourself, when you are in such a position. In other words, go through the process yourself in your mind as I explain it step by step for our benefit. You will seldom hear this from the member. Normally this is part of a workshop. People come forward and explain this. Yet I have decided to talk about it because many a times it's not spoken about. And it's an important consideration for us to recognize the process of the ritual dealing with the dead body. When you and I are next to an individual who is about to pass away, he or she is in a state of ihtivar. Ihtivar means what? Ihtivar means that they are ready to depart from this world. What do we do? Because unfortunately, some of us, what do? Is we cry. We throw ourselves on the body. These are makruh. Our ulama say it is not recommended to cry next to an individual who is dying. Ulama say it is makruh to be in the state of jinaba or hayf, in other words, impure physically next to an individual who is crying, who is about to die. We need to be in the state of purity, ideally in wudu. If the person is about to die, what do? We close their eyes. And at the same time, we recite Quran next to them. Which chapters of the Quran should we recite? We recite Surah Yasin and Surah Saffat. Remember this. These two have been specifically mentioned by the Ahlul Bayt alayhum salam as chapters of the Quran that will help the deceased in these final difficult moments. And later on, inshallah, I will go through what the person actually sees in these moments. Because now the discussion is about the ritual aspect of death. We will then go into the spiritual, or what happens to the soul. So what we are told is that we need to recite the Quran. What else? We need to recite the talqeen. What is the talqeen? The talqeen is a dua that we recite in order to establish and make the belief of that individual absolutely firm in these final moments, because doubt comes to their minds. We've put them in the position of facing the Qibla. How? That if they were to stand up, they would be facing the Qibla. In other words, their feet, when they're lying down, wherever they are, on the hospital bed, at home, their feet is facing the Qibla. That if we were to help them sit up, their face would be in the direction facing Mecca. If we are at home and we have somebody who is passing away, it is highly recommended to take them to a place where they used to pray. They used to perform their salah, their musalla. If it does not involve any hardship or difficulty for that person, no adha. If that person will not be harmed, take them to the place that they perform their salah, and you will see that they will become more comfortable. Because we are told the place that you perform your salah is sacred. And every time you come to do your salah, change the place, wherever you are. Why? Because that location will intercede for you on the day of judgment and will act as a witness that you stood before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you performed your prayers. In other words, change the area that you pray. Even if it's a small step or a few centimeters. When the person dies and their soul leaves their body, what do? We close their mouth. We close their eyes. And we place their hands right next to their feet. We extend their feet and we cover them with a sheet. These are all recommendations in the Sunnah. Thereafter, we do not leave them in a dark room. Narrations tell us that if an individual dies, keep them in a well-lit room. And ideally, you should not leave them alone. But of course, sometimes this is difficult. But if it is possible for someone to stay there and to recite the Quran with them, then do so. Keep them in a well-lit room. As soon as that individual dies and passes away, of course, it's not haram to cry for them, to somehow express your grief and sadness over this loss. But indeed, it is highly discouraged. And some of the scholars have come forward and said that you should not express what? Jaza'. Jaza' is what? Sometimes we see people banging their heads on the wall. We see sometimes some of our sisters tearing their clothes or their abba or whatever in anguish or in difficulty or in grief. That should not occur. In fact, there is a kafara for doing so. There is a punishment or a compensation that has to be paid if an individual does this. The only people whom we should express grief and sadness towards in such a state are the Ahlul Bayt alayhum salam. And that's where the riwayat point us towards. The other recommendation is what? When an individual dies, spread the news of their death so that the believers prepare themselves to take part in Salatul Mayyit and come for what? Tashi'ah. Come for the funeral process. The next step is what? The next step is ghusl. Ghusl, my dear brothers and sisters, is wajib for every Muslim and Muslimah. And the person performing the ghusl is not allowed in Sharia law to take money. Not allowed to charge. It must be for the sake of Allah. It must be free. Ghusl should be performed for whom? For any human being who's a Muslim who is over 4 months old. Who's what? Over 4 months old. So sometimes we have, unfortunately, for instance, people having miscarriages. If the child is less than 4 months old, there is no need for ghusl. If they are 4 months old and or older, ghusl needs to take place. Why? Because narrations tell us at 4 months, what happens? the soul is blown into this particular small flesh. And indeed the ruh will become present. The ghusl would then take place. How does it take place? The ghusl would take place in the following ways. The body is first of all washed from any impurities. And it is highly recommended, my dear brothers and sisters, for you to attend the ghusl of a person who has passed away. I ask you and I recommend you from an individual who takes part on this process on a regular basis. Why? It opens up your heart. It makes you reflect, what would I do if I'm in that particular position? Musa alayhi salam one day asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, oh Allah, what is the reward of an individual who takes part in the ghusl of another? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would respond to Musa and he would say, oh Musa, the one who takes part in this particular process, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses him and sends malaika to perform istighfar for him or her. Of course, the ghusl cannot take place between genders. So if an individual who's passed away is a male, then the males must wash their body. And if it's a female, the females can wash the body, except in one circumstance, and that is husband and wife. Only in this particular instance, the husband can wash the body of the wife, or the wife can wash the body of the husband. However, this is not recommended. It is recommended for this to be what? Gender by gender. What we find is that ghusl is wajib kifai. What is the term wajib kifai? Wajib kifai means that if no one does it, somebody has to do it. That if you are in a particular place and a Muslim dies and nobody washes the body, then it is incumbent upon you to do so. That's why you need to learn. That's why you need to acquire the skills to be able to perform the washing of the body of the deceased. How does the washing take place? What is the philosophy of washing anyway? Washing, as far as we can understand, this ghusl process of the body that has just departed from this world, seeks to demonstrate that the body is now beginning on a new, fresh journey, is a fresh outlook, is a new life. Notice how a young baby, a child, when they're born, immediately the parents do what? They perform the ghusl, don't they? They cleanse the body. They cleanse the body, and therefore this is an indication when it comes to death that the body is cleansed. Number one. Number two, the religion of Islam emphasizes the sacredness of the Muslim's body. It is sacred. Therefore, what? It must never be mutilated. It must never be disrespected. It should be buried as soon as possible, because that would be comfort to the soul. Therefore, washing the body somehow is an element of respect to the deceased. How does the washing take place? There are three washes. Please pay attention to this. Three washes that take place. First is with water that's mixed with berry leaf called sidr. A bit of sidr is taken, mixed with water, and the body is washed all together from top to bottom. Every part needs to be covered. As soon as this is finished, the second part is water mixed with camphor. Kafur. To the extent that you can smell the kafur, the camphor. And the third washing is what? Pure water with no addition. If the body unfortunately has gone through burning, for instance, or water cannot get to it, what do? We do tayammum. That tayammum is permissible in this particular instance. After the washing is complete, we dry the body. And now it's time to place the kafan. The kafan, my dear brothers and sisters, has three layers. Has three layers that are wajib and should indeed be present. There is the shirt. There is indeed the whole sheet that the body has to be covered with. And finally, there is a part that covers the body from the chest towards the feet. These three are used. But before the kafan is placed, we have to do a process known as tahniyat, What is tahneet? We place camphor, kafur, on the seven parts of the body in which prostration is felt. The seven areas of sujood. So camphor is placed, for instance, on the forehead, on the knees, on the elbows, on the hands. These are placed, why? Because we are told that these are blessed areas of the body that has met the ground in prostration, in demonstration of the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and submission to His might and power. After this process and after the takfeen takes place, the body is brought forward for what? For Salatul Mayyit. Now Salatul Mayyit is indeed something that does not require wudu or purity. So if you're not in wudu, or if you have not done your ghusl, for instance, then you can stand there and join the imam. The imam stands next to the body. If it's a male, he stands next to the head. If it's a female, he stands next to the chest. The body is placed. They are facing the qibla, and the imam recites five takbirat. Five takbirs. The school of Ahl al-Bayt says they are five. Other schools of thought say they are four. What's the difference? Why do we have four, by our brothers and sisters in other jurisprudential schools, and why is it that we have five in our school of thought? Imam al-Sadiq salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi was asked this question. He was asked, why is it that we have five takbirat? In between the takbirat, there is a dua which is highly recommended. That if the believers say, Allahumma inna la na'lamu minhu illa khayra. Oh Allah, we do not know anything about this person who has just passed away except good. Wa anta a'lamu bihi minna. You are more knowledgeable about him than us. And then we pray for this particular deceased individual that Allah forgives their sins. Why do we have five takbirat? Imam Sadiq says this is the reason why. Because Imam says in Islam was founded on five principles. Was founded on what? Five principles. As-salah, as-sawm, al-hajj, and zakat. As well as what? Wilayatu Ahl al-Bayt. The fifth is what? Following and becoming obedient to whom? The infallible, pure, immaculate, sinless, error-free family of the Holy Prophet. The Imam says other Muslims do not believe in wilaya. That's why they have what? They have four takbirat. As soon as the salah ends, the body is about to be taken. Now when it comes to the kafan itself, some people ask the question, does it need to be white or can I have things on the kafan? It is recommended that you have on the kafan what? You have dua jawshanul kabir, or you have ayatul kursi, or you have ziyarat ashura, written on the kafan with what? With za'faran, with the water of za'faran written on it, on the kafan. That will help. Yet some of our ulama today, some of our maraji' have said, it is better for the kafan to remain white and for the other kafan that has dua jawshan al-kabir to be placed right next to the deceased in the grave. Just in case any impurities will touch these words, any impurities that might emerge from the body that might cause the kafan with these words to become najis. Therefore, what happens? We are told it is highly recommended to have your own kafan. To prepare your own kafan, my dear brothers and sisters. The narration from Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. He says, من حيأ كفنه لم يكتب من الغافلين وكلما نظر إليه كتبت له حسنة. Whomsoever prepares their kafan will not be considered of those who are what? Who are of the ignorant ones, heedless ones. Every time you look at it, you will be given a hasana. It's a wonderful process to prepare ourselves. The body is then taken. The Muslims are taking part in this process of funeral, of tashi'. It's highly recommended to what? To take part in the funeral process. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the Ahlul Bayt says, If you and I take part in the funeral, what happens? 70,000 angels pray for us. 70,000 angels descend and perform istighfar for those who are taking part in the tashia of the body of what? The believing man or the believing woman. The body is taken, but it shouldn't be taken and straight away put in the grave. The recommendation is that what? Three times it should be placed down. Three times it should be put down and lifted again. People, when they are taking part in the funeral, please understand this. They should not be laughing. They should not be speaking and talking about affairs of this world. They should be continuously in the remembrance of Allah. Saying La ilaha illallah, reciting the salawat, reciting Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un, recalling the process of death, being in the state of dhikrul maut. When the body is then lowered inside the grave, what happens then? This is a time for talqeen to take place. Once again, the talqeen takes place. What happens is an individual comes, places his right hand on the right shoulders of the deceased and his left hand on the left shoulders of the deceased, holds them firmly, and the talqeen begins. Talqeen says what? Isma, ifham, listen, understand. Ya fulan, ya fulan. Alasta ala al-ahd alladhi ahadtana bih? Are you still in the covenant that you have promised us? Annahu la ilaha illallah, that there is no Lord except Allah, wa Muhammad al-Rasulullah, and the Holy Prophet is the final messenger. And then these particular beliefs are reiterated, and the particular person is shaken, so that they understand, because they could hear, they could listen to these words, they could see their bodies being what? Being buried. The soul is lingering. It's about to be joined with the body inside the grave. At that moment, the narrations tell us, these are all from the books of a fuqaha, all people except the family should take part in placing the soil and the dust on the body. Why the family should not take part? Because it brings darkness of the heart. Qaswatul qalb. If you are burying yourself, your loved one, and taking part yourself by placing the soil, this is not recommended. It's not haram, but it is discouraged. As soon as the body is covered with soil and the qabr is there, it's recommended for the believers to take their hands and place it inside the soil and recite Surah Al-Fatiha and Surah Inna Anzalnahu Fi Laylat Al-Qadr 7 times. This is recommended. And at the same time, what do we find? We find that the talqeen should also take place. That talqeen takes place 3 occasions. At the time of ihtidhar, at the time when the body is placed in the grave, and finally when the grave is sealed. 3 areas in which the body is prepared. Thereafter, people leave. People depart from the cemetery. Yet we are told of the importance of visiting graveyards and cemeteries. We are told of the importance that the Prophet of Islam would come to the Jannatul Baqiyah, the cemetery of Baqiyah. He would address those who have passed away. He would say, Assalamu alaykum, ya ahl al-diyar, 3 times. Rahamakumullah, 3 times. We are told that Sayyidatul Nisa, Fatimatul Zahra, would visit the grave of the uncle of the Prophet Hamza. We are told that Imam al-Husayn salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayh would visit the grave of his beloved brother Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba on a frequent basis. Visiting the graves is of the utmost importance. Allah says, Alhaakum al-takathur hatta zurtumul maqabir. That when you and I bury a loved one, we should make an attempt to visit them as much as possible, perform a'mal for their sake. Hence, when we understand these rituals, it places us in a good position to be able to face this reality, this universal law. And one of the individuals who faced it on the 10th of Muharram was whom? Was Al-Hurr ibn Yazid al-Riyahi. This man who had been sent by Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad to do what? to surround Imam al-Hussein, to stop him from reaching Kufa. What happened with this man? This man was from Bani Tamim. He was an individual who is known to be generous. He came to Imam. When he came to Imam with 1,000 soldiers, Imam looked at the soldiers. Imam al-Hussein was full of love and compassion. Imam looked at Hur and saw that his soldiers were thirsty. He said to his companions, feed them water. Remember that Imam al-Hussein did not have enough water to last him, yet he would feed his enemies water. He would present the army of Hur who had come to surround him with water. But not only this, my dear brothers and sisters, if you are to talk to a non-Muslim about Hussein, make sure you mention this. That one of the soldiers of Al-Hur said, I was late. And I came and I saw people being fed from the army of Imam al-Hussein, being fed water and giving water to our army. I saw a man standing. I was thirsty. I needed water. He came to me. I did not understand what he said. He said to me, come down. I came down from my horse. He started feeding me water. And at that time, he looked at the horse and he started feeding the horse water. I asked, who is this man? They said, this man is Hussein. That even the compassion reached to what? Reached to the animals. That Imam would feed the animals water, Allahu Akbar, despite not having much water himself. Al-Hur continues until he sets on the plains of Karbala. On the 10th of Muharram, Al-Hur is standing there. He's confused. He looks at Umar ibn Sa'd. He says to him, Amuqatilun anta hadha? Are you seriously going to fight this man? Are you going to kill Hussein? Umar ibn Sa'd says, E wallah, yes by God, I will fight him to the extent that the heads will be beheaded and the arms will be amputated. Al-Hur is standing there. He's unsure of what to do. The message of Al-Hur is absolutely emphatic. It's a brilliant lesson for all humanity. That when he stood there in these moments, what was going through his mind? Someone looks at him and says, Ya Hur, I do not know of anyone more brave and more courageous than you in Kufa. But I see that you are uncertain. I see that you're doubtful. What's happened to you? Hur says, indeed, إني أخير نفسي بين الجنة والنار. I am in between paradise and hell. فوالله لا أختار على الجنة شيئا. By God, I will not place anything above Jannah. وإن قتلت وحرقت. Even if I'm killed or burnt. He then rides on his horse and charges towards the area of Imam al-Hussein, the campsite of Imam al-Hussein. He looks up to the heavens. He beseeches Allah. He says, O Allah, I have sinned and I have wronged. Ilahi, ilayka unib. The message of Hur is absolutely beautiful. It's never too late for any human being. It's never too late for you and I, my dear brothers and sisters. We may have done things in our lives that we have regretted. We may have done things in our lives that we should not have done. We may have sinned and transgressed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of judgment will bring Hur as proof. He will say to people, look at this man. In the final hour, in these final moments, he chose eternal bliss, eternal success, and a legacy by which billions of people throughout history send their salutations to him. How? He chose the path of freedom, the path of righteousness and purity, the path of repentance and tawbah. He comes next to Imam al-Hussein, his head down on a horse. Sayyidi Aba Abdullah, I am the one who brought so much difficulty into you and your family. I've brought sadness and anguish. I am the cause that you're here. Halli min tawbah. Is there a way that I am forgiven? Imam alayhi salam, full of mercy, looks at him and says, of course there is an opportunity for you. Imam says to you and I, of course there is an opportunity for you. It only requires you to look and to open up your hearts to the mercy of Allah. Imam says to him, of course there is tawbah for you. يَتُوبُ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكَ. Allah will forgive you. Come down from your horse. Al-Hur says, no, Ya Aba Abdullah, please excuse me. Because I, on the horse, I'm more powerful. I'm more effective than being on the ground. One thing that most of us don't know about Hur is the following. That as soon as he said this, he did not charge towards the battlefield. With Hur was whom? Four of his sons. Four sons of Al-Hur ibn Yazid, Al-Tamimi, Al-Riyahi came with him. When they were indeed inspired by their father. In fact, three came with him. The fourth one came after Hur was martyred. Ali ibn Al-Hur ibn Yazid Al-Riyahi. Who else came? Mus'ab ibn Yazid Al-Riyahi, the brother of Hur. Who else came? The servant of Hur. Notice that historians tell us 33 of the army of Umar ibn Sa'd were so motivated and inspired by Hur that they joined the army of Aba Abdullah al-Husayn. It sometimes needs the actions of one person to inspire others. It sometimes needs one individual to make that all-important decision and others will follow suit. And how beautiful is the stance of Al-Hur ibn Yazid al-Riyahi. He sees his children being slaughtered, three of his children being slaughtered. And when he sees this, he charges towards the battlefield, wanting to protect the sanctity of the family of the Holy Prophet, defending Aba Abdullah al-Husayn. He charges towards the battlefield, fights courageously. One narration states that he killed 70 of the enemy combatants until he finally was surrounded and he attained martyrdom and shahada for the sake of Allah. Aba Abdullah al-Husayn comes next to his body, sits next to him, and looks at him and says, O Hur, may your mother who called you Hur be blessed. Indeed, O Hur, anta hurrun fi dunya wa sa'idun fil akhirah. You are free in this world, and indeed you will be prosperous and successful in akhirah. One by one, the companions of Imam al-Husayn embraced this journey of death with full conviction, with full happiness, with joy, and one of them with whom was the man who was Christian a few weeks before Karbala. His name was Abu Wahab al-Kilabi. Some people have confused his name. They say they call him Wahab. His name is Abu Wahab al-Kilabi. He had just got married and he was Christian. Him and his wife and his mother happened to be on the way towards where Imam al-Husayn was going, towards Karbala. Imam al-Husayn invites them. At that moment, his mother looks at him. She says to him, oh my dear son, do you know who this person is? This particular individual looks at his mother and says, who is this man? She says, this is Hussein, the son of Ali. Do you know who Ali is? Ali ibn Abi Talib was the man that myself and your father went towards. When we couldn't have any children, we were Christians, and we went to him and we said to him, Ya Ali, we know that you're a servant of God. We know that you're a man who's close to God. Pray for us. Notice how Amir al-Mu'mineen did not say to them, you're Christian, I will not pray for you. He did not question which religion they followed. He prayed for them. And you were born because of the dua of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Wahab responds to the call of Imam al-Husayn. On the 10th of Muharram, he stands to fight. His wife, he just married for a few weeks. He was still in his honeymoon period. His wife pleads with him, begs him, says to him, oh Wahab, don't make me a widow. Oh Wahab, do not deprive me of you. Do not leave me by myself. His mother says to him, do not listen to her. Go and fight. قاتل مع الطالبين. Go and seek this martyrdom. Wahab goes towards the battlefield, fights so courageously, but then returns to the campsite. He looks at his mother and says, Umma, our feet, have I done what I have to do? Of course, they had become Muslim. They had embraced the religion of Islam. His mother says, oh, my dear son, no, you have not done what you're supposed to do. Go back and fight and attain martyrdom, shahada, so that on the day of judgment I can face Sayyida Fatima al-Zahra. I can say to her that my son Abu Wahab has sacrificed his life for the life of your son Hussein. Make me proud, oh my son. Abu Wahab is about to go to the battlefield, and he hears the call of his wife. His wife would say to him, قاتل مع الطالبين, fight with the Ahl al-Bayt, defend the sanctity of the Ahl al-Bayt. He is surprised, his wife is changed. His wife is no longer pleading with him not to fight. She's sending him towards the battlefield. He says to her, oh my wife, why is it that you've changed your mind? She says, La talumni, do not blame me. I heard the cries of Aba Abdullah wa qillata nasira. Ala hal min mughithin yughithuna. Ala hal min dhabbin yadhubbu an harami rasulillah. I heard the cries of Hussein pleading for help. Go, my husband, go and fight. Abu Wahab goes to the battlefield. He is surrounded and captured. Umar ibn Sa'd decapitates his head and throws it towards the campsite of Imam al-Hussein. His wife goes next to his body, sits next to him, cries and weeps. Says, oh Allah, join me with my husband. Shimmer hears this, says to one of his army commanders, says, join her with her husband. That man takes a spear, he directs it towards that young lady. The spear penetrates her body and she falls. She is the first female martyr in Karbala. Allahu Akbar, the mother looks at this sight. Allahu Akbar, can you imagine the mother looking at her son, at her daughter-in-law, both slaughtered in Karbala? She comes forward. Now she's happy that her son has been sacrificed. Can you imagine how Fatima al-Zahra would look, would feel when she sees her son Hussein all alone in Karbala? Wa musibata. ألا لعنة الله على القوم الظالمين وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون والعاقبة للمتقين. نسألك اللهم وندعوك باسمك العظيم الأعظم العز الأجل الأكرم. يا الله يا الله يا الله يا الله يا الله. إلهي بفاطمة وأبيها وبعلها وبنيها والسر المستودع فيها يا الله, فرج عنا وعن أهلنا فرجا عاجلا قريبا يا أرحم الراحمين. تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم. اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين واخذل الكفر والمنافقين. اللهم دمر أعداء الدين. شافي مرضانا ومرضى المؤمنين والمؤمنات بحق مريض كربلاء زين العابدين المؤسسين لهذا المجلس الشريف. تقبل اللهم أعمالهم وإلى أرواح أمواتهم وأرواح أموات الحاضرين. رحم الله من قرأ الفاتحة تسبقها صلوات.